give you the podium, and then we look forward to you. First of all, I'm going to talk a little bit about the history of totem poles in North America on the West Coast, in British Columbia, Alaska, and some in Washington State. And weave into that some of the issues that have evolved over the years. And then I'm going to go to another series of slides about the cultural presence of the totem pole art in British Columbia, and talk a bit about training programs and that sort of thing, and then finish off with a series of slides on assessment and documentation of a World Heritage Site in southern Haida Gwaii, which is an island off the coast of British Columbia. So, go in here. So, in the history of totem poles, goes back to records that were made by explorers in the late 1700s, and then when the fur trade started happening with the Northwest Coast, the traders were collecting sea otter pelts, and the whole relationship between First Nations and traders quite flourished quite a lot, and quite a lot of totem poles during that period. And then, towards the end of the 18th century, the 19th century, the missionaries started coming to the Northwest Coast, and as well settlers, and then disease. And so a lot of troubles happened as a result of that, and that disease really decimated populations. Haida Gwaii, which a lot of these photos are from, the village of Skidigit, principally. All of Haida Gwaii had a population of over 10,000 people, and by late 1890s, the population dropped to 600. And, you know, this is sort of a typical scene. Totem poles everywhere, and families in pretty traditional garb, and this is the way things were looking when it all started to kind of unravel. Okay, from a preservation point of view, there's still a certain perception that totem poles have a religious or at least a spiritual role in their presence in the tradition of the world. It is true that they do represent cultural history of the tribes from which they originate, and they do garner much respect. The notion of having a symbolic, pagan, primitive purpose of worship definitely dates back to a time of Christian missionary work in the late 19th century. Misunderstanding confused by the perception of sin. So that's the background of my first issue, which I'm on the record having ranted about in the past. You saw the kind of village formation with all the totem poles in sort of a curving line facing the bay. And this was the principal form of transportation. We saw the canoes there as well. reason they were curved around that way was in the form of greeting, and they were signs, and I'll talk later a little bit about the fact that in the Northwest Coast there was no written language, so the totem poles actually represented a really important form of communication. They told stories of tribal history, they told about cultural events, and they had a really significant part in the history of the culture. The outcome of the perception, the religious perception, of course, became the destruction of totem poles, and whole villages, once they were converted, were convinced to take down and destroy their totem poles, and some villages had hundreds of poles. They were even laid down as a roadbed for a new main street in the village of Massey, which is where I have a series of photos to take you to an event there. And this is a southern village in Taiwan, south of Skidia. It's Tanu, but I'm not absolutely sure. And then I thought I'd show you some slides by Emily Carr, who traveled to the Northwest Coast and from, she made a few trips between, in the early 1900s, from 1912 was maybe your last big trip. And I'll just run these by, because they're a nice historical record. This is a famous totem pole from Alert Bay, and that's a Walker's pole, which is now been copied and is on exhibit in Stanley Park in Vancouver. And the original, I think I've got this right, the original, which has been more or less restored, is in Ottawa at the National Museum of Civilization. And she was she really valued sculpture and sculptural form, and her paintings are pretty impressive. And she's definitely one of Canada's most renowned artists. And this is a typical kind of village scene, but kind of at the time, by 1912, things were starting to be, Western-style homes were being built, and the old longhouses were starting to be abandoned. And I should bring up, I guess, the subject now too of around the same time, all the big museums in the world were starting to, get established with programs of collecting First Nations art from the Northwest Coast, because it was feared that it was a vanishing, the people were a vanishing culture, and that they needed to be saved. This is more on the car. This is in Skidiga, 1912. And there's a double thin killer whale. We've been having discussions about the killer whale and from the embassy, which only has one fin. But sometimes it seems to be going backwards rather than forwards. But in this case, it looks a lot the same. And this is one of those complex, you're starting to